just in front of us.
In your writing, would it possible what is your life and came from your life background?
No, I am now writing my autobiography, which is tentatively titled as Born Without Wings. So the idea is I am tracing my childhood life around the village, how I have grown up, in what kind of circumstances I have grown up. Because one of the major influences that made a turn in my life was going to the school from sheep. See, I was a shepherd, I was a cattle rearing boy. I think I must have gone to school when I was 8 or so. My brother was about 10. Both of us went to school at the same time. Now my mother told the teacher when he came and asked that no, why don't you send your two sons to school? She said, you know, if they go to school, they will die because in our family, there is no tradition of education. Then, you know, it is generally said that Saraswati will kill Sudra children who go to school. So then he said, no, Saraswati is goddess of education. Now then my grandmother, my father's elder mother, his mother died earlier than that. So she said, no, Saraswati is a devil who kills Sudras and Kurmagollas who goes to school. So our elder boy died when he was writing some letters when we sent him to a tutor, so these people also will die. Now from there, see, the whole story of education, Saraswati being against us, and then starting going to school. School was a kind of jail for me, because I used to play with cattle, goat, washing cattle, running around along with them, watching they not jumping into the field, so things like that. Then we both of us, we were put in the school, not my sister. But then what took a major turn was in the fifth class, we were sent to a bigger village called Kodur. My village is known as Papayapet, which is in Narsampet Taluk, old Taluk, and now it is Chanaraupet. This comes under the former Talukdar, a Reddy Talukdar whose name was Maibub Reddy. He was given these lands, about the entire Taluka lands, by Maibub Pasha, who came to hunt there. And his father put the child at his feet and then made him the Jamindar and Jagirdar, everything there. So our village was very backward village, and it was forest based village, and we did not even have much agriculture in those days. So basically our life was around sheep, goat, and some cattle, buffaloes and cows and bulls we were acquiring, because my mother was a dynamic. So she sent us to school in opposition, when many were opposing. Then in the fifth class, after that was over, she requested a Reddy to take us to Gudur and admit us in 6th class. There was a huge landlord there called Epur Lakshma Reddy, who was literally ruling the school. So my mother, he said, you bring them to that landlord, I will also tell him. So he came along with us. My father was very innocent. He used to always sit, and he was not well also. For a long time he was not well. So my mother used to take care of everything. The sheep herds, she was caste head. Her name was Kattamma, Kancha Kattamma. She was in a way popular in that caste community and in the village. So she took us and put at his feet that I have to beg her, please admit them in the school. So he wrote a slip that admit them in the school, and then we were living in a small shed, four kids of us. We used to cook all the time. But then once my mother, since we got admission in that school, there is a big Lakshmi Narasimha Swami temple there. So every summer, people carry baskets of sweet food cooked in pots and what they call bonam and puttu to God. She brought all the way from the village, and we were, since living there, we all went to the temple. There was a huge priest with a bulky body. He was incidentally the brother of our own classmate. There was a Brahmin boy called Rangachari in my class. This priest was his brother, and normally his father also would be priest, both of them. So they said, leave the coconut there and the food you can't put here, and some money, he said, 5 rupees or 10 rupees, you put the money there and be away from the temple. So she put all that there, and she gave some body to all of us outside the temple, far away. After all, we are shepherds and we are not untouchable. But then he broke the coconut, half of it he kept and half of it he gave to my mother. So we bought what they call chilkalu, chilkalu, all those things. So then it stuck, look, you know, we had to, my mother put me at the feet of a landlord. Then my mother brought food for the guard because we are here. The priests, they were very hefty and bulky, father and elder son of his. His son was, his youngest son, who was my classmate, was not at all bright. My brother used to top the school class, and I used to get the second mark. This boy, who never used to get good marks, but they were supposed to be very great in the eyes of God. So then once happened, what happened, this landlord, I think I was in 7th class, we used to cook, eat food with tamarind liquids and some pachas, and we used to live in a very bad shed where there were a lot of rats and what we call pandikokulu, putting all the mud hills all around it. So we used to cook in that house, somehow manage, and I was very sick all the time. So he gave us the scout dress, first time, you know, khaki necker and shirt and red shoes. So my brother was comparatively good in health, and the classmates I had in that room were also better. They were elder to me, actually. In those days, in 60s, only big children from the villages could go to school. So one day I cooked my food, because my brother used to leave all the cooking on me. we cook our food, and they ran to the scout, whereas I went to the scout a bit late. So this landlord was sitting under a tree when the peon was holding umbrella on him. So I was running into the queue. So he stopped me. So he stopped me and said, ask the peon to bring him here. So shivering, I went there. He said, why are you late? I said, sir, I cooked my food and I am not also well. So that's the reason why I am late. So he said, take away his shoes and dress. So the peon just pulled off my shoes and dress. That was the first time I had shoes. Otherwise, earlier we used to go to school on slippers. So, you know, even those rubber slippers were the first time I saw in my life. But then it was shocking. I went back on my banyan and dryer home, weeping all the way. My brother and others were in the drilling. So there was a very deep anger in me that why these landlords are doing like this, why the God is doing like this. So after that, in my ninth class, after seventh, my health deteriorated. After eighth. So my brother was there. I was shifted to Narsampet, which was the taluka headquarter, better town. So I had good marks in 8th class. So I went to the headmaster on my own. My mother, could not come. My brother had some problem. So I took my TC and went to the headmaster. He admitted me, gave a slip to B section. So there was one teacher called Narsimhachari. He looked at my slip. I said, why this headmaster is sending all these useless fellows to my class? This Yellaya, Mallaya, Ilaya, you don't know how to study, you're all bloody rascals, you should have been with the cattle or in the agriculture. Why are you coming to school and why does this headmaster admit all of you only in my section? So I bent my head down and okay, he entered my name into the register. Then I started going to school. And that very year late, my brother also was shifted to that school. Then in the quarterly examination, he was teaching us Hindi. He used to always insult me. See, I was very thin with smallpox face. My brother was also, he had a much more horrible smallpox. I had this smallpox when I was a 6 months old child. I would have died at that time. Then I had a burning here because one day when I was 2 years kid, I was sitting in winter near Puyi, that hell. So I had what we call arakatna, that some cloth was wrapped up around me and that got fire. So it burnt many parts of my body, including the face. My mother was sprinkling dung water. My sisters were also there. She came running and then hit every fire all on my body, and then somebody brought water and poured. So this is because of that burning. So my face used to be in a way ugly in that sense of what beauty. And my brother also had a very thick, piercing smallpox when he was 2 and a half and I was 6 months. So, I started feeling that in the in the class that on the one side you have humiliation, the teacher thinks that you are useless. So I used to study very seriously. But even then my brother used to be first. So in the what we call quarterly exam, I got highest marks in Hindi, and the same teacher valued the papers and looked at it. Hey, Ailaya, come here. So I went there. Hey, you are all right, you are right then. You got highest marks. I just bent my head and folded my hands, stood there. So then, you know, I used to read and read. Then there were some teachers who used to teach well. We had one English teacher called Buchiramulu or something. He was a come up by caste, but teaching all right. I mean, then I used to learn quite a bit and started reading whatever comes to my. So my brother and others, they used to go for play. They were, he was class monitor, so on and so forth. Whereas I used to cook, wash the dishes, and then be around books. So, but what happened in 9th, suddenly my mother developed in summer, after we passed 9th class, fine evening, she went to seedle the groundnut and came back. She became slowly became unconscious because she got tetanus. She was all the time fighting within the caste against a caste rival who was also slightly, literate fellow. His name was Kore Veeraya. He was police patel of the village. Somehow he managed police patel. He used to harass my mother a lot because she was educating us. And so in some quarrel, her relatives bet her. And she got bad blows on her back, on her chest. And she took an injection from a whack who was an old guy. That injection he gave her, hand became very swollen. So that got septic. So she got tetanus. So then she became unconscious. That night, bullock cart. We had a bullock cart by then. Our agriculture was much better. She was the one who improved agriculture. We used to have, 3 loaves. That's supposed to be in the Kurma community, good agriculture. Moon Nagala, Vyosayam, Gurlu. She was head of the family. Now suddenly she became unconscious and we took that night in the bullock cart to Narsampet town where we were studying, and there was only one RMP doctor who was ready. Even now he's alive. So we took her to his hospital and I literally went and fell on his feet that you have to save my mother. He did all kinds of things, but by morning he died. So we brought her back and then I held the funeral pot. The only worry was that maybe we'll have to stop studying. So my father was innocent, my brother and sisters were married. So then I held the pot, I'm writing the whole story. We took her, we burnt her, then till 9th day, all kinds of things. Kati Papalolu, Ganget Lolu, all these people came. But on the 11th day, 2 priests came. One was from Gudur, a Brahmin, and one was from Narsampet, a Jangam. So we all did whatever rituals we had to do at my mother's kadu, where we burnt her. We burnt her in our own feet. That's where nearby now the English medium school has come up. So we went to the street. What happened? We had our clean shaven heads with the barber, and the whole village came, and we ordered quite a bit of toddy and liquor. People drank liquor, toddy, because that was the custom of the caste. So then the priest performed all the rituals, you know, put green grass rings and water pouring and all that. Then whatever, they read out some mantras, both of them, one after the other. And this Brahmin priest had a long buttu, and the jangam had a attabuttu, that is the ubidi buttu, what we call. Now, we are supposed to be, the Kurma community was supposed to be Shaivite community. So that's where the jangam comes. Now, this must have come from Karnataka. This community must have migrated from Karnataka maybe around the 12th, 13th centuries after Basava's movement. So we had that Shaivite, and we have Unnikankanam, Pattikankanam, that is, you know, wool of sheep and cotton, and these are different things. Then what they did, all the rituals we did, they asked for, each one of them asked for a cow. Mm-hmm. My father said, we don't have many cows, I'll give some money instead of cows. And then rice, cooking material, everything was given to them. They cooked the food at my home. They were never eating with us. So, and then they were demanding, each one of them were demanding 1,016 rupees. 1,016 were very big money in those days. That was 1967. So the caste elders and my father, my sisters, they begged him to take less money, all of them. Then finally that agreement was reached, and the Brahmin priest touched his feet. That now, okay, finally touch our feet. So I rebelled. We have done everything, and I'm not going to prostrate on your feet. This is taking away our self-respect. Because by then, I was reading general books. My brother used to read class books very much, but I used to go to library, read anything that comes to my hand, even newspapers on the road. We never used to buy a newspaper. Even in shop, if you get some folding papers, I used to get them and read whatever comes to my mind. So there was some rationality that was working in my mind. I said, I will not touch the feet. Then both my brother also said, no, we don't do that. I also don't want to touch. Because why this is, we are now studying. So they said, this is the way you spoil these children. Since you sent these fellows to school, they got spoiled, and they don't even want their mother to be in heaven, and they are committing a crime against their mother. I spontaneously said, Pantul garu, you know, we never expected our mother would die, and she was looking after us. We have not come to an age where we did not take care of them or whatever. But she has done everything for us. Now we will have to do everything for them. But why this touching of the feet? So he called all the caste people and said, no, these are rebellious fellows, and don't send children to schools like this. They are getting spoiled with these all bad ideas. If Brahmin priests are not, their feet are not touched, what is this sanctity of this whole ritual? So all the caste people started against that. And I was very important in that because I held the Telugu. So they saw me as a rebellious fellow, having held the Talaguru. Then I said, no, come what may, maybe if there is a sin, I will die. Or I don't know what happens to family, but this feet touching, I will not. So then both the Brahmins got up and went away. And obviously they took more money from my father. And they went, in spite of that, they went with all kinds of curses. So the community started abusing us and looking down, and education is bad. So my father went into a depression. Now, this is how education is taking revenge on us. So this whole education taking revenge, maybe by then my grandmother, who said Saraswati would kill us if we go to school, she also suddenly one day died when we were in fourth class. She went to toilet and came back and put our, what we call, you know, munta there, dodi munta we call. And then she fell down and died. So there was a whole atmosphere of depression, and my sisters were very unhappy, and then they were saying, Tami, what is this? Abba has done so much for us. He has educated you all, but the priests have gone like this. What will happen to the family? So all kinds of problems, psychological problems. So then we had a brother who was adopted when we were not born from my family. His name was Kumaraya. He was married, but he didn't have children. So he started rebelling against the whole family. So he wanted to get out of the family because these educated fellows are rebelling against the priest, and they are educated and illiterate. We don't know what they will do in future. So they wanted to divide the family and get away from it. So the whole family was in a crisis. Now, once the crisis is lit by the priest, it becomes huge. So then somehow we convinced our father, at least let us finish 10th class. My brother and myself, we decided that then my sisters and the whole family, the caste community came and said, you know, by then we were supposed to be late unmarried. By then maybe I was 16, my brother was 18. So till then there was nobody of my age unmarried till the 9th class. So from class 5th onwards they were looking for the marriages, but I was rebelling. My brother was saying, wait. So that was one of the worries of my mother. So what we somehow convinced our father, and both of us continued in class 10. And in class 10, we looked for, my brother and my relatives looked for a girl for my birth brother, who lives with me now, and he got married. That was in 68, 69 March, something like that, he got married. Then I requested him that we should somehow manage 11th class. You on and off come to the school. I will spend more time in school. So we requested one of our sisters in-laws to see that these spares are time more for agricultural work, looking after my father. My brother already rebelled and then he got separated. They adopted the house. So we had four sisters and two brothers. So elder fellow, adopted fellow went away along with his wife to whatever property that villagers decided. So I had to continue this education. Then I convinced my brother and his wife, very young, who my sister-in-law who is as now. She was very young. I mean, she was when she got married, she must have been around 11 years or so. So I said, I'll continue off and on. So I continued 11th class, and that was the year Telangana education came. The whole education got disturbed, and I was enthusiastic to participate in it, and my brother was occasionally coming to school. We begged the headmaster and others to give him attendance, but because of Telangana education, school system got totally disturbed. So the one complete year we lost in that. And that was the time when I picked up my speaking in public. So there was series, even now you can see them in library. Panuganti Lakshmi Narasimha Shastri wrote a series called Sakshi. So in that, there was a character called Jangala Shastri who comes to public and gives speeches. So I started reading that book from 9th class. So Jangala Shastri, when he came, Sabha was like this. He's a big orator. So I read almost 4 volumes by my 11th class. And I was deeply impressed, and I read some Telugu books. I was fond of English poetry, and there was a very nice teacher called Krishnamurti who used to teach Hindi. He was a Brahmin, but a very efficient teacher. So I used to mug up Hindi poetry a lot, and mug up Telugu poems, Telugu Mahabharata, Ramayana kind of stories. So in 11th class, we took the examination very late, almost 8 months late. So everybody was allowed to write examination. It was full copy. Teachers were writing answers and giving to students. So my brother, since he did not come regularly to school, he had to depend on me. Now somehow I decided I will not. But all my classmates used to say that you will pay. So I did not copy. Maybe here and there, whenever I got doubt, because papers were all around. But I tried to write mostly on my own. In mathematics, there was a very famous teacher called Satya who was a mathematics. He used to go to his home and learn mathematics. He sent all the problems solved. So everybody entered those problems, but one problem I found it was missing. So I did that problem on my own. Mine was correct, all of them last mark. So I topped the school that year. That was in 69 October, November, last leg, this thing. The whole academic year, 1 year we lost. So, you know, then when I topped the school, I remember 71.6% or something I got. In other subjects, they did not look at the papers properly. I got less, but in mathematics, I got maximum. So that's so. Then I said, since I came school first, all the teachers appreciated and all that. I told mathematics teacher your sum was wrong, and I did on my own. I have shown him what how it is correct. So then I convinced my brother and my father, I will go for PUC, that we need to go to Warangal. Only in university there was pre-university course, Warangal Arts College. But then my father was, all the time was crying that you should get married. Sambandhalu are coming, you should get married. And HSC was fairly good degree in those days. So we would have easily become teachers or postal office. If you just apply, postal service jobs would have come. There were many opportunities with HSC in those days. So then I said, no, I am not going to get married. My father became very sick all the time. His worry was my marriage, mother died, who will take care, how this brother's family will take care, elder brother has gone away. I was very lean all the time. So he thought I would die, I mean, with all this madness. So I went to PUC, then I took biological sciences, started studying seriously, but English was a major problem. I got third class. So I thought of going to medicine along with a classmate called Srinivas. You know Sudhakar education, his brother. He was the topper of the district, Srinivas.
In PUC.
He was the topper in PUC in my college. Then I was competing with him, but he got a distinction, I got third class. And he joined medicine, I couldn't even think of medicine. So then I took, I convinced my brother, doesn't matter, I will do BA. So I did BA with English literature, history, English literature and all. Now that is where I learnt about Marxism seriously. And all my anger again is the sugar loss. A poor Lakshma Reddy who maltreated on whose feet my mother put. He was ruling all our villages. My Mahbub Reddy, entire history. I'm writing all that. If my health permits, I'll write the whole book. So then I started reading Marxism seriously. Then there was a library opposite to my college. By the time I finished BA, I read half of the books. And Argopal was public administration teacher, not he was not teaching me. There was a very fine English teacher, creative, but very temperamental, Jaganmohan. He was in Kakatiya University, English. He was teaching us English. And Varadachari was teaching us English. And Venkateshwarlu, who was in Kakatiya University, taught us political thought.
BV. BV.
So, and Vakil taught us. And, so I was history. Soma Reddy taught me history. We used to laugh at his reading, teaching of history. He was not a very good teacher. So I completed BA, but again copy. PUC was copy continuing. I refused to copy. BA, myself and Ravindra Shastri, both of us were classmates. We decided not to copy with the influence of Argopal. So then Argopal used to conduct essay writing, debating writing. First year, I didn't get anything. Then he said, your English is bad, otherwise you are making good effort. Then I started reading, speaking in the mirror, going to social welfare hostel, radio, listening every day, 9 o'clock night news, invariably at the social welfare hostel. We used to cook in a room, four of us. And that's how I started learning my English accent. Because Jaganmohanachari did not have that accent, or Vardachari. There was one Brahmin teacher called Lakshman Rao. He became the first head of Kakatiya University. Lakshmanamurthy. So these Varavar Rao, Kaloji, Tangshal, Ashok, all these people used to have Kavi Sammelnams. I wrote few poems, but they never played my poems.
Mm-hmm.
So whenever I used to go to poetry recitation, they do not even look at our faces. So then somehow I started developing hatred towards them. In my PUC I wrote one poem. There was one fellow who came from outside, used to write poetry, Deepam, this and that. So I also, he used to appreciate whatever little bit I used to write. So that's how I began to learn this Kaloji, Varavara Rao, Dakshinamurthy and Lochan, all these Warangal Kavi gang is Brahmin. Later they also were the most radical revolutionaries everywhere. You know, I remember when I was in 11th class, Varavara Rao came there when he wrote his first book called Chali Negallu or something. So, you know, we used to have good image of those intellectual poems, poetries or poets, but they were absolutely arrogant Brahmins. I never got any respect among them from my student days. And so I never used to go to those Kavi Sammelnams after my PhD. And then from second year onwards, for whatever debate, English, essay writing I go, I used to get all the prizes. Hargopal was a kind of progressive, so I used to get all prizes. Then he finally conducted an IAS model interview in which I talked. I have that certificate even now with me. So this, then the anti-feudal feeling deepened in me. I read Marx, starting with reading Marx in a political thought book. Then I read quite a lot during that period in the regional library opposite to Arts College, and also library, the main library of Arts College. So that's how I entered into the Marxist movement. And then in 74, though I got a third class, all of us got third class, myself, Ravindra Shastri, because there was no proper valuation. There was mass copying in those days. So we came to Hyderabad to write the first entrance that Narottam Reddy conducted. And because of that entrance, I got seat in the MA. Otherwise, marks-wise, perhaps I would not have got, because I got a third class. So that was the first time when I saw Hyderabad. I came to A hostel, you know, in Tangsal Ashok's room. Three, four people used to. One was Ramulu, CPM leader, and present CPM leader. One was Pullaya, and Prabhakar, the Telangana Prabhakar, was our PDSU leader in those days.
You are working with PDSU?
Yeah, I was there with PDSU for a long time. From 74 to almost 78. Then I went into Nagiri.
Whenever you come to this university, how you were treated all of staying in the upper caste people? Was there any discrimination in the department and this university at the time of your study and you are being as a professor?
No, see, when I came to the university, put application in this arts college, there was the psychological shock that this is a huge college. But I had the knowledge of Warangal, hearing about this college and so on. But what was shocking in those days was that most of the teachers from the upper class, there was no single teacher came who came from our background, feudal or Brahmin, Reddys. Ram Reddy used to have a big aura around as head department, though he was in London when we came here. He was actual head, but he went to London. So they used to talk about Ram Reddy in a eulogical terms. Now, the entire campus was full of Reddys, Velamas and Brahmins. Largest number were Brahmins. Velamas were few, Reddys next. So the Reddys used to basically follow the Velma intellectual, the Brahmin intellectual tradition. They never were rebellious. But there were some around the radical left movement, the communist movement. So, since those were the days, 69 was the year when 67 Nagireddy rebelled against the CPI, CPM, and then All India level split in the communist movement took place, the radical communists. So by 69, Sitaramaya, all these people formed this People's War, and there were divisions, Pulla Reddy group on one side, Nagireddy group on the other side, and Sitaramaya. So those conflicts were there. So the entire campus was divided between, among students, the radical left, PDSU was the only organization, and ABU. So the upper caste, by and large, were around ABU. The teachers, they were supporters of ABU. But the students were, majority of them were with the left, PDSU, radicals. So radicals were very active in lectures, reading, Marxism. So that was a big cultural shake-up for us, and talking against landlords, feudalism. That used to attract many of us, because I faced the kind of story that I told you, that, you know, Reddys and Brahmins and all these structures were in my mind. So among teachers, see, one humiliation I felt was my name, my physical appearance, and but I was good in English. Right from those days, I was trying to push myself into an area where I am the best. So I used to read, I used to sit in the library and ask questions in the classroom. So the weaknesses in my physical this thing, I was trying to overcome by becoming intellectually active. You know, it is a psychological kind of environment. So in every class I used to ask some question. Nobody used to ask. And we have a very brilliant classmate called Kulkarni, who was a Maharashtra Brahmin boy, but their parents were here. He was the topper actually all the time. And he was a great Marxist, very silent. He used to read all the library here, tell about books, and but you never speak in the class, go and personally influence people about Nagireddy group.
Now he is alive?
He is alive, working in tribal areas in Gujarat. He is still my friend. The only friendship he maintains is with me now. He didn't marry, his father died, his mother died, and he was with Nagireddy group. They sent him to Bombay slums, and he lived in Bombay slums. From there he went into Gujarat tribes. He is now living in Gujarat tribal people. Very great guy. So we used to discuss. He, me, and there is one Mausam Ali in Hyderabad University in political science. They were all classmates. Shastri never used to discuss, you know, with us many things. So so we used to discuss, and so this, to overcome this name backwardness, the caste backwardness, I used to read books and become at least more visible and acceptable. I was not a leader, but I was a kind of intellectual orator. I was a speaker also. PDSU would call me whenever there is some meeting to come and speak. I would not go for stoning the buses or this and that. But when there is a long march, I remember in 75, when Bhumaya Krishna and the orchestra were hanging, were being hanged, we took a procession and went to jail. That's where I met Kanaviran. I wrote that about. So I decided that I should continue my studies and read Marxism seriously, become an intellectual activist. That's how slowly. So teachers were okay. I mean, they were thinking that Ayla is a good student, but this Marxism, people like Madhusudan Reddy and others, they used to dislike our Marxist background. And but they used to appreciate Kulkar. In fact, they wanted him to join as a lecturer here. He did not. Whereas I wanted to become a lecturer because that would give me life. He has seen life, you know, he came from Maharashtra. Kulkarnis were a big upper caste. So then in 76, I got bare first class in MA, 61 point something. And then I requested Professor Ram Reddy, who was principal here, that I need some job. Then he said there is this IAS coaching center which Madhav Rao started. Go and work there as tutor. So I used to get 300 rupees and work as tutor. Teach senior people. Several of them are IAS. There was one tribal man who became IAS and died, Tukaram. He was in that batch. And a famous IAS officer in Tamil Nadu called Rajkumar Ambedkar was in that batch. I was very young, used to sit on the table and teach Indian government and politics to them. They were very senior people. So I started my life like that. While used to participate in PDSU activities and seminars, every seminar I would attend and go to ICSSR seminars, read. Then I thought of taking admission in 76, but they did not give me. So then they said, if you have two articles, you will get. Then I started writing, thinking. So in 77, I wrote one article on elections. That was emergency was over, elections came. I went to my village, studied that election and wrote an article. I showed that to Professor Ram Reddy. He said, it is not good, nobody will publish. But then I got, there was one professor called Shivaram Krishna in English. Here, very well-known English professor. So I used to get corrected with him. I sent my first article after he made some corrections to mainstream. That was published in May 1977. So Ram Reddy was shocked. So mainstream was supposed to be a very big journal. EPW and mainstream. So many were changing the names. I did not change my name. I refused to change it. So there were humiliations. There was one professor called Raghavendra Rao in sociology. I used to try to learn English from him. I used to go to his house. I lived in his house for 6 months or so. And I used to take dictation for his PhD. But sometimes he used to humiliate, very bad humiliation. Used to face fools, rascals, used to abuse us. But then I used to put up with all that. Used to learn English. Then Many of them used to speak only in English in those days. So then I wrote one essay, I think in 75 or so, which is in the Hostel magazine, called From Toe to Head English. People, you know, from toe to head,
yes,
they behave as if they are English. So there is conductor English, there is this English, there is
but
that English. But university teachers think that they are only English people in this country and so on. So I used to make attempts to write. Keshav Rao Jadhav was bringing Olympus journal in those days. He used to do a lot of such work. So I wrote my first article on Kurma caste,
mm-hmm,
its anthropological evolution, in 78 or so in that magazine. Then I wrote one article in Secular Democracy, which had a lot of stature in those days. That was being run by a big team of scholars from Delhi. So I used to make efforts to write, speak, and then in 78 I applied for lectureship along with V. Satyanarayana and others, but I didn't get. V. Satyanarayana got, even though he did not have any publications or anything. By then I got my MPhil admission also. In 77 I took MPhil. Next batch I got admission because I had articles.
This belongs to which kind?
V. Satyanarayana?
Hmm?
No, V. Satyanarayana and OBC,
mm-hmm,
but he came from Professor Ram Reddy's village.
Okay.
He had a long term. I think V. Satyanarayana's father used to work in their estate. So he got that job. Okay, he was senior, 1 year senior to me. He taught it at Jangam and he got that. So there was, the atmosphere was not in a way humiliating so much because of the left movement. Teachers were afraid of various things, and there was that class sympathy also. That environment, if it was a normal reservation situation, perhaps I would have faced all kinds of problems. But the radical had that working class has the right to study. Working class, you know, these are all villagers, peasants, children, farmers. There is no caste dialogue.
Yeah.
But the Marxist dialogue.
Class dialogue
was there. So teachers could not dare to do that. But there was cultural humiliation. See, there was one Gopal Krishna in sociology. He changed his name, Gopaya his name. He changed into Gopal Krishna. There were many who changed names. So that kind of environment was there. But otherwise, the left movement saved us. And it gave us a huge reading culture beyond your books. The Western thought, and myself and Kulkarni, Mausumani, we used to discuss the whole world. What revolution is taking place, what is Maoism, what is Marxism, what is Leninism. So reading all kinds of books and discussing about China, about US, about many things in those days. So Kulkarni went into the full movement. He took me into the as a sympathizer to Nagaradi group. Then I became OPDR organizing secretary later. So Kulkarni was a full-time party worker. So he went to Bombay to organize working class. So he used to stay in slums, and once I went to live with him, they used to sleep in turns. 9 to 1 person. There is only one bed. And 1 to 8 o'clock another person. Like that. In toilets there used to be queue. You need to get the toilet time after 2 hours. He used to live in such places. I also was. So he was such a great committed person who himself came from Brahmin background. But there was no caste thing. Mauzum Ali used to debate with us from a Muslim background that revolutions are bad, Islam does not agree with it. So he used to tell us he will disprove Soviet Union. Then of course finally he did his PhD on Soviet Union. So then I used to read Indian history. I used to went into all kinds of rural economy and civil liberties, democratic rights and so on. That's so from 81 to 96, 80 to 86 I was with Nagireddy Group, PWD, against PWD we were, OPDR. Then from after that I joined APC. Till Kanaviran, Bhargopal, myself, all of us came out, I was with APCMC. I became first their joint secretary, later on became, after a major debate, caste system came into it, and then they did not agree, however. So when Bhargopal was about to become president after Kanaviran, we had a major debate after 90 Mandal situation. So as a compromising candidate, M.T. Khan was made president. Bhargopal general secretary. Bhargopal one vice president, I was one vice president. I wrote a big letter to the APCMC president and secretary that caste must become one of the key issues in promoting people, if not on Ambedkar lines, because Ambedkar did not work with common parties, upper caste headed parties. He started his own, but at least on Lohia lines. So after a lot of debate, they very sharply attacked me, criticized Purushottam, who was shot dead. In APCLC, one day abused me like anything. He said, you have not sacrificed anything. You are not capable of running this organization. Do you want to become general secretary like Bhargopal, who sacrificed his lecturer job, who is a great intellectual in this country? So in executive committee meeting, he said that. I said, I know about sacrifices. If I resign my job, what I can't even come to this meeting.
Yeah.
Whereas Kanaviran, Bhargopal, Bhargopal, if they resign their jobs, their caste will finance them. Their relatives are there all over. Whereas who is there for me? So all my relatives are very poor. They come and sleep in my house for medical help and school admission, college admission, and my sisters, my brother is a dependent on me. So that kind of sacrifices we can't make, because definition of sacrifices was different from Gandhi, Nehru and Ambedkar. So I then gave the example of Gandhi leaving the practice, becoming the property of Baniyas and making Congress the Baniya property. Nehru leaving the practice, becoming the property of Brahmins, and how Congress is also made their property. Whereas Ambedkar had to work, and he was sometimes practicing law. He was his wife had no food. He organized trade union movement. His children died because of starvation. So luckily, by then I was not married, because all these crises I was facing, I was avoiding marriage. I wanted to marry one person, but that lady also did not like to marry me, because I am a very unpredictable kind of a person. Politics, when does he go into ML politics, or what will he do, So I said, okay, you know, if you have no willingness, there's no problem. I left at that. So then I brought my brother's family, because he sacrificed all the life, and he had 3 children, and he suddenly got major heart problem. In 79, Professor Ram Reddy, of course, supported me. Madhusudan Reddy was somewhat helpful in that. So I was a documentation officer. So I took my brother to Vellore. Sociologist Suryanarayan Reddy came to give blood there. Srinivas' wife, Andhrajyoti Srinivas' wife, Sudha,
yeah,
she came to Vellore to give blood.
Mm-hmm.
She stayed there for 15 days with me.
Mm-hmm.
And Suryanarayan Reddy stayed there. So there are many friends that way helped me in so many things. But I was a sort of ideological leader, even in those days. In any seminar I would speak, in any debate I would go. In the department, I was a very serious teacher. Even as documentation officer, I used to go and take classes in Secunderabad Evening College. So for 8 years, I had to be documentation officer. So what they did was, they did not allow me to become lecturer.
Mm-hmm.
So I became lecturer after everyone. After Kodan Ram Reddy, after Kodan Ram Reddy was junior to me, Ravindra Shastri, Tirupati Rao, V. Satnayana, all of them did not have as much work as I had, but I became lecturer only in 1986,
mm-hmm.
proper lecturer, along with Professor Lakshmi, myself. So they did not allow me to become lecturer on permanent basis, because once I become lecturer, they thought they will not stop my growth. So I did not do my PhD. By then I started working on Gautam Buddha's political philosophy for my PhD. So I had problems with Madhusudan Reddy. So I had to change my guide.
Was he your guide?
Yeah, he was my guide in MPhil.
Uh-huh.
I did my MPhil on land reforms in Andhra Pradesh. That thesis, somehow it is missing. I am unable to. It was one of the best records on land reforms and the implementation part of it. Can come up as a book, actually. But original copy, not a single copy is available. So I have to locate that. He was my guide. Then I registered under him, but he was all the time trying to oppose me becoming
your ideas.
And he was saying that feudalism, all this nonsense, you should not talk. And you can't be OPDR leader like this.
Mm-hmm.
So they were opposing me because I was OPDR. Serious activity.
He was engaging with RSS and ABP forces.
He was sympathetic to them. He was appearing to be sympathetic to everybody. But basically, as a landlord, he was with them. They were trying to take
him. What was he opposing with the Democrat?
Democrat. He was saying that he was a Democrat, but to show go to my academic record, I could not become lecturer when Kodan Ram Reddy became, and V. Satnayana became, and Tirupati Rao became. I applied all the times.
Shastri.
And Shanta Sinha.
Okay.
Ajay, uh-huh. Her husband.
Okay.
I was a candidate with all of them, but I did not become a lecturer. Only in 86, along with Professor Lakshmi, who came from Andhra Mahila Sabha, I could become a lecturer. Myself and D. Satyanarayana, who was another documentation officer. So, I mean, these problems were seriously there. So I started growing in my field parallel. okay, you don't care me, you don't give me lectureship, but I'll do my work. So I wrote my civil liberties based book, the State and Repressive Culture, in competition with Bal Gopalaswamy.
Mm-hmm.
In those days they were not considering me as intellectual. Any writing I do, they don't care. So I published all my reports into that in one book. I only published that book.
Okay.
Under the name of Swechha Publications.
Mm-hmm.
Some friends, like I had to ask Narasimha Reddy to write D.N. To write the introduction,
mm-hmm.
Keshav Rao Jadhav,
mm-hmm.
for credibility.
Okay.
But APCLC people, none wrote introduction to that.
Mm-hmm.
Kanaviran. Or they did not come to book release function.
Oh.
It was released in Chikkadapalli library. Suji Taru,
mm-hmm.
and these feminist groups used to support me. Rama Melkote,
mm-hmm.
she was my supervisor.
Okay.
They came to that book release. So I was in APCLC at that time. So they did not a single person came to my book release.
Mm.
Yeah. So these problems were there.
Because of caste?
Yeah, caste, and they used to think that I am arrogant, I am trying to become intellectual.
This is assertive,
yeah.
kind of.
What kind of intellectual he is?
They made a statement.
Where is
Bal Gopal?
Where is Bal Gopal? Where is Ailai?
Yeah, yeah.
I was not known as Kancha Ailai. Later on, I started writing as Kancha Ailai.
Okay.
In Frontier.
Okay.
I used to regularly write in Frontier. EPW,
mm.
mainstream.
Mm-hmm.
But Frontier, I was a regular contributor.
Mm-hmm.
So, you go to Frontier copies now, hundreds of articles I wrote.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that was the most radical journal in those days. But nobody used to respect my articles from Andhra Pradesh. They never used to treat me as intellectual. So then I did not get discouraged. Okay, I have to go on writing and doing my work. After all, someday, some people. Luckily, in 85, Karam Chedu came. So I joined Dalit Mahasabha. Now they used to give me some.
You were the member to Dalit Mahasabha?
Yeah, I was member.
Mm-hmm.
With Kathi Padma Rao, I was state member.
Mm-hmm.
I used to travel all the coastal states while
okay.
being APCLC. For some time I was just...
Then you resigned to FCS?
No. I was, after resigning OPDR, I was with Dalit Mahasabha.
Okay.
When in OPDR also I used to go to... I became a member of Dalit Mahasabha again as the organization.
Mm-hmm.
Their state committee member. So I used to attend all the meetings of Dalit Mahasabha. Sometimes refused him to go to OPDR fact-finding committees.
Mm-hmm.
Then we started the feeding centers in Mahbub Nagar. Starving people. So I mobilized in those days 5 to 6 lakh rupees. I went to organization, put feeding centers for 3 villages, 2.5 years. We gave food. I used to go every Saturday and create logistics for 1 week and come back. So these, then we brought out that report called Annapurna Rajyamlo Akal Chawal booklet. And then when Vangaviti Ranga was murdered, we brought out a booklet on the state and caste, cultural ethos, political and cultural ethos. That report, Usam Shora must be having a copy. So we used to do all parallel work. So quite a lot of work in those days when there was no recognition. Only we used to have some small groups around Dalit circle.
Mm-hmm.
In a way, I am certainly indebted to Dalit. In my formative stage, there was no OBC constituency. So it was Dalits who were giving me some platform. There was no OBC place in those days. So I was only an OBC. But they were all basically Telugu speakers. I was trying to develop English writing and all that. So till Mandal, I continued like that. After that, I started developing parallel writing with Economic and Political Weekly article, experience, reservations, experiences, framework of debate. So I used to organize around feminist groups, Dalit groups, and also occasionally coordinate with the civil rights. I was with the FCC.